Hi everyone, in this video I will explain you jaundice in detail. So I will explain jaundice under these headings. One is definition of jaundice, the second one is classification of jaundice, and the next one is hyperbilirubinemia, biochemical findings in urine for different types of jaundice, and the last one is enzyme markers useful in different types of jaundice. So these are the important questions for your university exam. So regarding the first topic, that is definition of jaundice. So to define jaundice, what should be the plasma bilirubin level? The plasma bilirubin level should be more than 2 mg per deciliter. So if the plasma bilirubin level is more than 2 mg per deciliter, that bilirubin is diffuses into the surrounding connective tissues. So that will produce yellowish discoloration of skin, sclera and mucous membrane. So jaundice is the yellowish discoloration of the skin, sclera and mucous membrane associated with plasma bilirubin level more than 2 mg per deciliter. So this picture shows yellowish discoloration of the sclera. So what is the normal bilirubin level in a healthy individual? In a normal healthy individual, the plasma bilirubin level should be less than 1 mg per deciliter. Among this 1 mg per deciliter, the 70% is contributed by unconjugated bilirubin and remaining 30% is contributed by the conjugated bilirubin. So if plasma bilirubin level is more than 1 mg per deciliter, then that condition is known as hyperbilirubinemia. So for jaundice, the plasma bilirubin level should be more than 2 mg per deciliter. So if plasma bilirubin level is between 1 to 2 mg per deciliter, then it is known as latent jaundice. So normal plasma bilirubin level is less than 1 mg per deciliter. If it is more than 1 mg per deciliter, then it is known as hyperbilirubinemia. And if the plasma bilirubin level is more than 2 mg per deciliter, then it is known as jaundice. And if the plasma bilirubin level is between 1 to 2 mg per deciliter, then it is known as latent jaundice. So the second topic, that is classification of jaundice. So before going to the classification, you should know few things related to the bilirubin metabolism. So all of you know regarding bilirubin metabolism, it is the end product of heme catabolism. So heme catabolism in our body produces bilirubin. And this heme synthesis or heme catabolism takes place in reticuloendothelial system. So bilirubin formation occurs in the reticuloendothelial system. So just consider this bilirubin formation or bilirubin metabolism in three phases: phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. Phase 1 means that is bilirubin formation. So phase 1 metabolism occurs in reticuloendothelial system. Phase 2 means metabolism of bilirubin in liver. And phase 3 is metabolism of bilirubin in intestine. That is intestinal metabolism, liver metabolism and formation of bilirubin. So regarding phase 1 metabolism, the reticuloendothelial system produces bilirubin. And this bilirubin is unconjugated bilirubin. So unconjugated bilirubin is water insoluble form. They are in water insoluble form. So to excrete this water insoluble substance through urine, that substance should be in water soluble form. Right. So this unconjugated bilirubin is transported into the liver where phase 2 metabolism takes place. So what is phase 2 metabolism? It is just conjugation reaction. There is a conjugation of bilirubin takes place inside the liver cell. So unconjugated bilirubin is converted into conjugated bilirubin. So unconjugated bilirubin is water insoluble form, but the conjugated bilirubin is in water soluble form. So that is phase 2 metabolism, that is liver metabolism, which produces conjugated bilirubin from unconjugated bilirubin. And regarding the third phase, that is the intestinal metabolism, this conjugated bilirubin this conjugated bilirubin reaches the intestine through hepatobiliary duct, where this conjugated bilirubin is converted into urobilinogen. So that's all regarding the bilirubin metabolism. So bilirubin formation takes place in the reticuloendothelial system, and this bilirubin produces unconjugated bilirubin, that is water insoluble form. And this unconjugated bilirubin is transported into the liver with the help of albumin, where this unconjugated bilirubin is converted into conjugated bilirubin. And this conjugated bilirubin now transported into the intestine through the hepatobiliary duct, where this conjugated bilirubin is converted into urobilinogen. So if the pathology occurs in the prehepatic phase, that is production of more bilirubin by the reticuloendothelial system, then it is known as prehepatic jaundice. So what are the major causes? Any type of hemolytic anemia which produces bilirubin. Also it can be due to sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, malaria, or due to G6PD deficiency. So here bilirubin, for excess bilirubin, is due to hemolysis. That's why it is known as hemolytic jaundice. And in hemolytic jaundice, the bilirubin level is beyond the limit of liver conjugation. That's why it produces unconjugated bilirubin level, high blood level of unconjugated bilirubin. And if the pathology occurs within the hepatocyte, then it is known as hepatic jaundice or hepatocellular jaundice. So here it can be due to defective conjugation by the liver, or it can be due to defective secretion of conjugated bilirubin by the liver. So hepatic jaundice can produce both conjugated hyperbilirubinemia or unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. The major causes are, one is viral hepatitis. Any form of viral hepatitis can produce hepatic jaundice. So it can be due to hepatitis A, B, C or E. And alcohol intoxication also produces hepatitis. Then it is known as alcoholic hepatitis. And some drugs may produce hepatocellular injury. Then it is known as drug-induced hepatitis. So these are the different causes for hepatocellular jaundice or hepatic jaundice. One is viral hepatitis, and the second one is alcoholic hepatitis, and the third thing is drug-induced hepatitis. And in hepatocellular jaundice, there will be both conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. And if the pathology occurs within the third phase, that is the intestinal phase, then it is known as obstructive jaundice. So what is the major points in phase 3 metabolism? In phase 3 metabolism, this conjugated bilirubin has to be transported into the intestine, where this conjugated bilirubin is converted into urobilinogen. So if there is any obstruction within this biliary duct, this will produce obstructive jaundice. So conjugated bilirubin does not reach the intestine, so urobilinogen formation is absent in obstructive jaundice. That's why urobilinogen is absent in urine in patient of obstructive jaundice. So any type of biliary duct obstruction can produce obstructive jaundice. So the major causes are the gallbladder stone, which is obstructing biliary duct. The second thing is pancreatic tumor, especially the carcinoma of the head of the pancreas may obstruct the biliary duct opening. And there may be some congenital diseases like biliary atresia. Here the pathology is within the third phase, that is intestinal phase. That's why this obstructive jaundice produces predominantly conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So hepatic jaundice produces unconjugated hyperbilirubin. Prehepatic jaundice produces unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Hepatic jaundice produces both conjugated and unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. And obstructive jaundice produces conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So the first one is prehepatic jaundice or hemolytic jaundice. Here the pathology occurs prior to the liver, and it is due to excessive hemolysis. Here the bilirubin production exceeds the capacity of liver to conjugate, so it produces unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. And the causes are any type of hemolytic anemia. So it can be due to sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, G6PD deficiency or malaria. Hepatic jaundice is mainly due to inflammation of the hepatocyte. So this inflammation produces inflammatory edema within the hepatocyte, and this hepatocyte also contains intracellular biliary canal. So this inflammatory edema produces obstruction of this intracellular biliary canal. As a result of this, conjugated bilirubins are accumulated within the hepatocyte, and these hepatocytes are surrounded by multiple capillaries. So due to the pressure effect, these conjugated bilirubins are diffuses into the surrounding capillaries. So once this conjugated bilirubin reaches the capillaries, there is the systemic circulation, and these conjugated bilirubins are water soluble in nature. So they are transported through the plasma and finally reaches the kidney, and they are excreted through the urine. And this conjugated bilirubin, it is also known as bile pigment. So conjugated bilirubin is the bile pigment. So a patient with hepatocellular jaundice, urine may contain bile pigment. The reason is it is due to intracellular obstruction of biliary canal. And in case of post-hepatic jaundice, it is mainly due to the obstruction of the bile duct. And this obstruction blocks the passage of bile duct content into the intestine. The major content which is present in the bile ducts are, one is conjugated bilirubin and bile salt. So due to this obstruction, and this will lead to the development of pressure effect. So due to the back pressure effect, they again reaches the intestine, they again reaches the hepatocyte, and these hepatocytes are surrounded by multiple capillaries, and due to this back pressure effect, this bile salt and bile pigments are secreted into the surrounding capillaries, and through the capillaries there is the systemic circulation and finally kidney, and they are excreted through the urine. So patient with obstructive jaundice, urine contains bile salt and bile pigment. The next topic is enzyme markers useful in different types of jaundice. So we can classify enzyme markers of liver disease into two category. One is enzyme markers for hepatocellular jaundice or hepatocellular injury, and the second one is enzyme markers for obstructive liver disease. So the first one is enzyme markers for hepatocellular injury. So the major enzyme markers are the aminotransferase enzyme. One is alanine aminotransferase and the second one is aspartate aminotransferase. Among this, ALT is more specific for liver disease because AST is also elevated in myocardial infarction. So ALT and AST, these are the two enzyme markers for hepatocellular injury. The reason is usually these enzymes are located within the hepatocyte. So whenever there is an injury to the membrane surrounding the hepatocyte, these enzymes are secreted into the surrounding capillaries. So high blood level of this ALT and AST indicate any form of hepatocellular injury. And the second one is enzyme markers for obstructive jaundice. So just remember this enzyme name. One is alkaline phosphatase and second one is 5-nucleotidase and the third one is gamma glutamate transferase. These three enzymes are elevated in obstructive liver disease. And the last topic, that is physiological jaundice of newborn. So as the name itself, it is physiological. Physiological means it is not related to any disease. So it is common in our community, that is physiological jaundice. So how to differentiate a physiological jaundice from a pathological jaundice? In case of pathological jaundice, baby is born with jaundice. But in case of physiological jaundice, jaundice develops after the delivery. So usually in physiological jaundice, jaundice develops second or third day after the delivery. And what is the reason for physiological jaundice? So all of you know regarding the liver related, liver is the major organ which is concerned with bilirubin conjugation. So it is mainly due to this immaturity of the liver for the conjugation of bilirubin. And usually it disappears by second week of life. And usually this physiological jaundice does not require any treatment. So physiological jaundice, the baby is born normally and jaundice develops second or third day of life and it is relieved spontaneously by second week of life. But in case of pathological jaundice, the baby is born with jaundice. And sometimes this physiological jaundice may require treatment. Mainly the treatment policy is phototherapy. Then you should know what is the principle of behind the phototherapy. So regarding the geometrical isomers of bilirubin, bilirubin has two isomers. One is Z isomers and the second one is E isomers. The Z isomer is water insoluble form and the E isomer is water soluble form. So in phototherapy, this water insoluble Z isomer is converted into water soluble E isomer form. So once it becomes water soluble, this bilirubin can be excreted through the urine. So that is the principle behind phototherapy, conversion of water insoluble Z isomer of the bilirubin into water soluble E isomer so that it can be excreted through the urine. So that's all regarding jaundice. Thank you.